So I really have no control over whoever introduced me that way, okay? I'm really just here to disappoint everybody. That's also why they put me first. Right? It can only get better after my talk. So, can you see my password? You cannot, it's okay. Okay, so my talk is actually going to be about Kubernetes. I jumped in for a colleague of mine who was supposed to talk about Kubernetes marketing, more or less. So I have to disappoint you. I'm not going to talk about marketing. I hope that's fine. Because it's like super early morning, at least for me, because unless maybe 5 hours ago I didn't have a talk yet, I decided to start with a couple of questions, mostly to wake me up, but if you could help by raising hands, that would be great. So who in this room is using Helm? All right, so very few. That's actually good, because then most of you are doing it right, not using Helm. I was actually expecting this to be much worse, but we'll get through it. It's going to be fine. So who's using one cluster, so one Kubernetes cluster per application environment? Wow, you don't need me. Who's using one cluster for all your app environments? Maybe you're not actually using Kubernetes, because there's no hands, really. who thinks running Java in containers is a good idea? Very few. So that was actually a trick question. There's nothing wrong with running Java in containers. Yeah, my name's Philip, and I'm a law school dropout. You can find me on Twitter. This is my handle, I suppose. How did I end up here? So not necessarily only on this stage, but only in this, also in this job. So I started a PaaS company in 2009, when even I didn't know it was going to be called PaaS eventually. We were actually the company that acquired DotCloud from Docker. 2014. We went bankrupt in 2016 and got fire sold to this very nice Swiss company called Exoscale, which I left about a year later to start a new company, which I ended up not doing much time on. Instead, I joined CoreOS as the general manager for Europe. And then after we got acquired, so CoreOS got acquired by Red Hat, I decided a 15,000 people company is not for me. I mean, the biggest one, I guess, was CoreOS, which was like 150 people. And so I joined Container Solutions in April. Why do I tell you this? I'm not looking for a new job, even though I'm now a consultant, which I hate. This was the one thing I never wanted to be, but I guess that's life. I also never wanted to be a public speaker, which I guess I'm not much of a public speaker anyway. I'm telling you this because for all of my career, all I've done is startups. All of them have been on the cloud. It was PaaS in the beginning, now it's Kubernetes, really the same thing as far as I'm concerned. Difference is only Kubernetes is like a little bit more brave to also run stateless workloads, which I think is a good thing, and you should be brave too. Stateful, sorry, yeah. And I've never done anything but run applications in containers. I've had a Windows computer when I was 14 last time. So, that being said, I'm talking about Kubernetes from day two. Day one is where we all try funny things, and day two is where we need to get serious because we actually have work to do. And the first thing is this. So I don't know, some of you might speak German. This basically means whatever you do, don't do it yourself. This is a quote from one of my favorite bands. It's called Tokotronic. You should go listen to it. But more importantly, this is basically my checklist of how I evaluate if you should be running Kubernetes. First thing, does your cloud provider have managed Kubernetes? Go use that. Okay? If your cloud provider does not have managed Kubernetes, maybe find a third party to do it for you. If there's no third party that runs this on your cloud provider, maybe you should go change your cloud provider to one that fits number one. If you can't do that, maybe package distribution, like, I don't know, Tectonic, which doesn't exist anymore, I would have recommended until recently, but maybe OpenShift now, or like an open source project like COPS could be a good option for you. If this is not an option, maybe consider not doing it at all. And if you really must, then you can build your own Kubernetes. I'm not saying this because it's particularly hard to run Kubernetes. I'm just saying this because there's really no value for most companies. Unless you're a company that wants to run Kubernetes for other companies, then being good at running Kubernetes really doesn't make your application much better. There's way more, the time you have is spent better making your applications run on top of Kubernetes, getting your CI/CD right, and all this kind of stuff, because that's what actually will help you build those applications that the companies you probably work for need. And if you just do it for fun, of course, you can build your own Kubernetes cluster with them, right? So I told you I'm unprepared. So I'm as excited as you are what the next slide might be. Apparently it's this one. When you start with Kubernetes, you're going to write a lot of manifests. And they can get quite verbose. I think it helps, at least me, to categorize them in those three categories. I start on the left with the orangey one. I consider cluster manifests, the stuff that needs to be on the cluster because you can do before you can do anything interesting. So that's going to be like ingress or logging, your monitoring integration, maybe a service mesh, but I'd recommend, I have a slide on this later, but do this at the very end. Stuff like operators, you know, like auto-update operators, stuff that does certificates, automatic certificates, stuff like this. I would consider cluster manifests. Then I separate into the next category, DevTool manifests, which is like your wiki, your task tracker, your code hosting, this kind of stuff. I would usually recommend going SaaS for that, not bothering running this yourself. But if you have to, I think it's helpful to have its own category. And I actually know what the next slide will be. And so when you see the next slide, it suddenly makes sense, I hope. Well, it made for me. And the last one is, application manifests. This is the bespoke applications, so the custom applications that you are actually building, maybe some commercial off-the-shelf stuff that you need to run, which is for the business. And last, maybe open source applications and stuff like this, right? So, what does it do that? I am a very strong proponent of running only one cluster, but there is usually a second one. But why do I say this? So in my opinion, you have, I call them the ops cluster and the apps cluster. The ops cluster is where the platform engineering team can move fast and break things. And the apps cluster is where the application engineering teams can move fast and break things. The idea behind this is that there are certain things about your cluster that you might want to be able to test before breaking the production cluster. You know, like maybe scaling up nodes, scaling them down, changing the API server certificates, introducing network policies, upgrading Kubernetes, and leveraging one of those new features, getting a new version of your service mesh. All this kind of stuff. So your cluster and the staging environment for what we called cluster services from the slide before, right? These ones. This goes onto the ops cluster. Everything else goes onto the apps cluster. This is because I feel very strongly that if you mix, for example, your dev environment for your applications and put that on your dev cluster, and you put your staging environment on your stage cluster, and then ops has to do something on the dev cluster, and then all the application developers can't work anymore because the dev cluster is currently broken, that's a production incident, in my opinion. If your colleagues can't work, it's a production incident, you are doing a bad job. And this is why I'm suggesting to have a cluster that you can break, and you can really work, and give an environment to the application developers where they can do the same. And putting all the application environments in namespaces will allow your colleagues to, you know, break the dev environment or break the staging environment for a particular application. But you breaking your ops cluster doesn't hurt them much. Okay. This is why I asked in the beginning who's doing that. But then either you were too tired to raise your hands or you don't run Kubernetes. So I really have no idea what you're thinking. Day three. So now, on day two, then we got the cluster right. There's actually no watch. I have no fucking idea how much time I have. How am I doing? You know, I'm on day three. I only have five, so. And unless you want me to tell more stupid jokes at the end, then I guess I have to talk slower. Okay, so day two was about getting your cluster setup right and making sure that you can actually work, because it's never done, right? You always iterate on your cluster and also on your applications. So you need to have a setup where you can do that. And day three for me is about getting the application basics right. I already said earlier that the idea for me is that most of the value is generated by getting the application on top of the cluster, right? Not necessarily spending time on making that cluster shiny. And as everybody knows, there's only two hard things in IT. I don't know why it always jumps two slides. There's only two hard things in IT. Cache invalidation, naming namespaces, and off by one errors, of course. And I'm going to talk about naming namespaces. That's why that's bold. My suggestion is that you have one namespace per application per environment. And remember, they all go on the apps cluster, right? What's in that namespace? In the namespace, all those Kubernetes resources that we all know and love. There's like services, there's config maps, secrets. There's a couple of deployments. Maybe there's a couple of config maps, right? Because what's an application? Anybody know what's an application? Any? No? This is not an interactive. Okay. Okay, I got it. So an app, in my opinion, is a group of Kubernetes resources that serve a common purpose. So anything that does something together, like a rule of thumb could be, if it breaks at 3 in the morning and you have to look at it, it should be in the same namespace. That's kind of how I look at it. Okay. And then the rule of thumb for what's a microservice, who knows that? Sorry? I don't know who James Lewis is, but maybe. My rule of thumb for, like, it's not mine, I read it on Twitter. So whoever wrote that is a smart person, in my opinion. Rule of thumb for microservice is, if you can't answer in a single HTTP request, if it's healthy or not, it's too big. Okay? And I have a slide on that later, too, also. Rent modus, right? This is why I ask if you're using Helm. Friends, don't let friends use Helm. I feel very, very strongly about this. Why? Okay, so there's three problems. I'm going to start with the first one and then work my way through. The first is, fucking hell. Do you like cursing? If not, I'm sorry. First is that you, if you have a template template language and you can write complex logic with it, you will do it. And that's a bad thing, because you end up version controlling only your templates without the actual input variables. Those are stored in this whatever Helm thing that it does on the cluster side. And you end up version controlling something that you then render, put in random input variables which you might have forgotten or have changed, and are trying to get out some kind of a manifest that you then try to apply to your cluster. And this will break, and then it's going to be terribly hard to debug. So I don't know. It's like the whole idea is broken, in my opinion. But I do understand that it's something that's very much common to how previous configuration management systems worked. And I think that's why it's so popular, right? It's everybody kind of has a feeling that it's kind of good, right? However, I think we all went on this journey of doing Kubernetes and containers because we wanted to challenge how things have been done in the past. And there are actual real benefits in doing that. This is why, number one, you shouldn't use Helm. Number two, why you shouldn't use Helm, the in-cluster component Tiller is a nightmare. So first problem with Tiller is that it sits inside your cluster, it gets a service account, and then opens an gRPC API from the outside. And every command that somebody types in on Helm goes around the API server, doesn't get checked by RBAC, but instead now talks to this Tiller gRPC endpoint. And from there, things are applied to your cluster with whatever admin privileges that Tiller usually has, which is a bad thing, because now suddenly it's not the question who is the person that, you know, you don't authenticate the person anymore and then authorize what they are they allowed to do. Instead, you're just having everybody who finds a way to be able to talk to your in-cluster Tiller do stuff with admin privileges to your cluster. Where I come from, that's a bad thing. And then their suggestion, I don't know if you've seen that, there's like a documentation page about how you secure Tiller. It's like 4,000 pages or something like this. Is basically just have a lot of Tillers, put them per namespace, per team, per something like this, and then manually put TLS certificates everywhere so that you can make sure only the person that has the matching certificate can talk to your Tiller. I think that's like a nightmare to get right, and probably nobody's doing it. But since you're all not running Tiller, I guess I'm preaching to the choir, I guess that's what you say. Third problem, and this is really, so there's like, I'm like in one of my favorite movies, there's like a saying, bad things happen in threes. Apparently for Tiller and Helm, bad things happen in version threes. First problem for the new version, in my opinion, is that it actually fixes the, well, that's a good thing, I guess. It fixes this problem too by removing Tiller. There's no in-cluster component anymore, so you don't circumvent RBAC anymore. I think that's already good. But then they decided to replace Go templates with the full-blown programming language, Lua. So all of you will even write more complex charts now, which is going to make the first problem so much more worse than having Tiller was actually maybe even the better option. So if you take anything from my talk, please don't use Tiller. Do yourself a favor at Helm. Don't use it. Obviously, then the question is, I knew that this slide was coming. Obviously, then the question is, what are you going to use if not Helm? Maybe you can shout some suggestions.
Customize.
Mm-hmm. He knows my slides. Actually, any other suggestions? I mean, I've used. Huh? I you want to switch places? No, I think KSonnet is interesting, but it suffers a little bit also from the too complex problem and what you version control isn't native Kubernetes manifest. I'm going to talk about this a little bit, but yeah, those are good alternatives. There's a few of them. Customize, in my opinion, is really the best one, and I'm going to talk about this in a little bit. But the first one is actually I'd like everybody to try the vanilla manifest for as long as humanly possible. Really challenge yourself to use what's in that manifests to get whatever you need done. One example could be, instead of writing a Helm chart that puts a different environment depending on what input variable you throw into your template rendering, right? See if you can maybe get this going by putting two config files in a config map and then mounting them both in some directory using the downward API to get the name of a label, the value of a label or the name of your namespace into environment variable, and based on that environment variable, read the correct one of those two configuration files. There's a lot of stuff you can do where at the end you still have only one set of Kubernetes manifests that you can version control with your application code in the same repository, even in SVN, I suppose, if you wanted to, right? This gets you a long way, right? And this is why I would invite everybody to try that for as long as humanly possible. In my opinion, there's a few things where this gets difficult, and then this is why tools like maybe Customize could help you. But this sets you on a very strong foundation, and also it helps everybody in the team understand what really is going on. Which is really important, I guess. So what's the last one about? All right. If you must, I would even start refactoring the application. I don't know, put like some initialization phase in it where it reads certain values or has like magic environment variables that you can use to control it. Most frameworks have this, right? Like Node.js would have this environment where you put like stage prod or something, and then based on that it does things differently. There's really no reason why stuff like this can't be handled with, for example, just a single Kubernetes deployment manifest and the downward API to set an environment variable. Ah, yeah, maybe a downward API. If you haven't heard about that, it's basically a way how you can mount a value out of the API server manifests into an environment variable or even a volume. So it's like a secret. You can consume it like a secret or like you consume a config map. But instead of being a value that you put there before, like a config map or a secret, it's just one of the values that used to be in the manifest. It doesn't support all the values in the manifest, but it usually supports like all the metadata kind of stuff, names and et cetera, something like this, labels, annotations. So it goes a very long way, usually. Then, if this isn't good enough, you've tried this and you're now at a point where you really need something, I would really recommend you take a look at Customize. Why? Because Customize does, and I didn't come up with this, probably somebody smart at Google did, does a declarative application management, or maybe it was the a smart guy on Twitter again. Ah, now I know what it is. I have my YubiKey, and then if I touch it, then it sends an enter, and that's why. Okay. I've also generated plenty of multi-factor authentication codes now. No, so declarative application management is amazing, and this is just copied from the README, so you could have also have found it there, but because it supports common customizations, you can have dev and staging and production environments, which is usually what everybody needs. But you always use native Kubernetes APIs. Everybody in your team continues to do so. There's nothing special to learn when you want to use Customize. It's just Kubernetes YAML. And it doesn't hide them from you. Like, if you've ever seen a Helm template, I have no idea what's going on. Go templates are also particularly ugly if they had used something like Jinja or something that people can read, right? But no. No friction. Is anybody here working on Helm? I'm not trying to offend anyone, right? I just have a different opinion. And I happen to be on stage, so I get to tell it. I got into a fight with a coworker last week because I said everybody who uses Helm is a bad person. And then my argument is, if I were to judge your character by your technology choices, I would be an idiot. Obviously, I'm not an idiot, so this is obviously a joke, right? You're not a bad person if you use Helm. You've just been misled, but we can fix that. I need to go get going. How much time do I have left?
You have plenty.
I have plenty. That's good, because I have plenty of slides also. So there's no friction with version control. You just put your manifests into a directory in your Git, and you version them with your application. It's really amazing. It's so easy. I mean, how would we do anything? Why do we want to do anything else? And then it kind of nicely follows the composability idea of a Unix command line application, which Docker also claims they do, but then eventually they stopped. All right. Customize has two things. Well, it has a few things, but the two most important ones are bases and overlays. Bases are something that doesn't inherit anything from anywhere else. Everything else is an overlay. Okay? They have like a nice line. There's no sub anything. Sub anything is not a thing. There's only overlays. Bases and overlays. Okay? You can have overlays of overlays also. Sometimes this makes sense. Here, this is an actual one of my, so you've seen this logo maybe earlier, CubeStack. It's like it's a site I run where I collect operators that I think are worthwhile. And I give you like a nice overview page of what they do and like a nice way, easy way to try them. And so the code examples I'm showing here, so the manifest examples I'm showing here, they're basically from how I run that site on my GKE cluster. So this does actually work, unless I did a copy and paste from the source code, but error, probably not. So I have my site is made of two things, a website and an API, and I also use a memcache operator, but it's not as interesting. And then I simply have those three bases. I have a lot of vanilla Kubernetes manifests in there, like deployments and services. The memcache one is a custom resource object. Then I have like cluster role bindings to get the operator running, right? And all of the directories, they have this customization.yaml file. This is basically the file how Customize knows this is a directory that it's supposed to do certain things on. And the things it's supposed to be doing, they are defined in this customization YAML. And in this case, what it does, it finds those three resources and will mangle them together. And the only change it makes to those resources is for every single one of them, it adds a label that says app is API. And then similarly, in the WW one, I have the exact same thing. I just specify the two resources that I want Customize to include. And then I set an app WWW label. Okay, so not very exciting. Then I have a bunch of overlays. And in my case, those are Minikube, prod, and test. So prod and test go onto my GKE cluster. And Minikube, you can probably guess, goes I'm using for my local development. So I can bring up a Minikube cluster. And my rule of how I use Customize is the bases have production settings. And so in my production customization YAML, you can see I overwrite actually very little. The only thing is I say my namespace. So all the applications, all the resources, all the manifests that I include, either as bases or as resources, will be put into this namespace. It overwrites it. If you don't have one, it puts it there. Then I include my two bases, which I reference simply from being two paths down, I guess, and then one up. I set another common label, which in this case, my stage is prod. And then I have two resources which are actually unique for this overlay, which is the namespace, because I don't have that in my base, right? And the ingress, which I need to have different domains on if I want to get this working. The test overlay has all the other stuff that the prod overlay has as well, just with a different namespace, of course. And it uses two other things. So here's where I patch. Patches are ways of overwriting individual values of your base. And there's also some special helpers. This example is image tags. This basically helps you overwriting the image tag without having to use a patch directly. The benefit of doing that is if you look at an example of a patch. So this one is for my Minikube, where I don't have as much memory, so I need to reduce the number of replicas of my API from how I run it in prod or test. But if you're familiar with the deployment YAML, you would know that the image tag comes much later in the tree. And so the further in to the hierarchy of a resource you have to go, a little bit more verbose those patches become. And especially for container images, that's like a little bit of a nuisance. And so I guess that's why they have this special helper. Also, what you can do with it, you don't have to specify the image tags in the actual overlay. You can also leave it out here. And then before you do a customized build, which is what I'm going to show you really soon, you can do a customized edit in your CI/CD, for example, to overwrite the image version with exactly whatever you just built in CI/CD. I wouldn't do this for prod, because for prod I would recommend tracking in version control actually which tags you were using. But for example, feature deployments or test deployments, stuff like this, that are actually triggered from CI/CD automatically whenever somebody pushes a branch or something like this, it could be really helpful to basically dynamically edit the customization YAML even before you build it and then send it to your API server. Last thing about the patch is, as you can see, it's really just another Kubernetes manifest with just the one value that you want to change. And the recommendation is also to say, even if you change two things in that deployment, have two different patches for it. So the patches are really small and just simply change one thing. In this case, the replicas, then I have one which changes some API URL, stuff like this. If you want to apply this to your cluster, this is all you do. You do the customize build and then the directory of your overlay. You could put it on the base too, but it's not very useful because then it doesn't have a namespace, at least in my example. And then you just pipe this into kubectl apply and off you go. One thing to be, this isn't specifically for customize, but you should be aware that if you remove a resource, for example, you remove a config map, and you remove the volume mount of the config map from your deployment, and then you kubectl apply, it removes the mounting of the config map, but the config map is not removed from your cluster, right? The resource that isn't part of the manifest that you apply is not deleted from the cluster. And so this is something to remember when you do this kind of stuff so that you can sometimes maybe clean up after yourself. There is a --prune flag, which would try to delete all the leftover resources that have the same app label, for example. And then there's like a white and a blacklist feature that you can try, but it's marked alpha. And so be careful when you use that. But it's something maybe to play around with and understand. So next thing I really, really want you to use are multi-stage builds. And I'm going to walk through actually the Docker file of one of my applications. Which one is it, actually? I don't know. Ah, it's the API. So my first stage is the build container. This is where I just use Python 3. I call it the... So who's familiar with multi-stage builds? Do I have to... Okay, so multi-stage build is basically when you have more than one from line in your Docker file. Okay? And then in the first from line, it's very common that you would do something like here. I do say from Python 3, which is just like a, right? The official Docker Hub Python image. And then I say, this now has the name build Python. And then in there, I do my kind of stuff. I add a user, I run it as a user, I set environment variables and do stuff like this. And then I eventually run pipenv install somewhere down there. And also, I happen to copy in my application source code. My application source code. Okay, so that's the first stage. So now this is on a different slide, but actually would be in the exact same Docker file. The second thing I usually put is the release container. And so here you will see that I say again from Python 3, sorry, but this one, the slim version, and I call that my release container. And what I do in here is, yes, I need a user in that container again because I actually want the application to run as that user. But other than that, you see there's this copy line down there that says from build Python. I do some ch own to make sure that it has the right user permissions, but I simply copy the output from my previous build into this container. And I leave behind all those temporary build artifacts that Python or pip might have downloaded, stuff like this, right? Third stage is my test container. And so here I say from release as test. Why do I do this? Because now I'm actually installing all my test requirements on top of the actual artifact that I will later run in production. So I'm testing exactly the one thing that I will later run in production. A lot of test CI/CD pipelines that I've seen basically do it the other way around. Sometimes they even build locally on Jenkins or something like this, not even in a container. Then they run their tests locally and then they put the output into a Docker container. That's very common in Java world, for example, and I guess it's fine because everybody thinks the Java JVM does the abstraction, but I would, even in that case, still suggest to investigate maybe using a multi-stage build like this because it doesn't cost you anything and it makes life so much better. And then the last thing is this. This might sound stupid that the last line in your Docker file is from release, but what this basically does is if you say docker build dot, you always get the release container. Otherwise, if I wouldn't be doing that, you would get the test one, which is not necessarily what you want. If you want the test one, you say docker build dash dash target, I think, and then test to get basically this container. Okay? So multi-stage builds are one of the greatest features that Docker introduced recently. I think you should all be using them. Okay? All right, CI/CD. How much time? 10:15. Okay, good, I guess. I hope. The tool doesn't matter. Use whatever you want. I don't care. Right? They're all the same. As soon as you start doing anything interesting, you end up fiddling around with their weird Jenkins file or whatever syntax they have and do random stuff. Okay? But go use one of them, any one of them. Use the multi-stage Docker file that I just introduced in your CI/CD to do the build and also run the tests. Don't build in another container that maybe the CI/CD gives you or stuff like this. Because you're not actually testing what you will be later running in production. And always start simple. So when you're new to this, you can get fancy later, but when you're new to this, what I recommend is just merge this into master, immediately get deployed to a shared test environment. This is fine for a lot of teams. When you get more than maybe 5 people, it becomes painful, but below that, it's usually manageable, right? You can go play billiard or whatever it is that your company has while you wait. And then to deploy something to production, I would just use tags. Just set a tag on whatever thing in master branch you want to go into production. Off you go. The feature branches thing is very helpful, but it sometimes can get like a little bit tricky depending on how many requirements your application has, right? How many different external services you need to talk to. It gets a little bit of like an orchestration challenge, but it's totally doable. So if you can and you have if you basically block yourself on the test environment too often, investigate if you can have the feature branches that individual developers work in also end up in feature namespaces where there's like a dedicated deployment of this engineer's basic current source code, basically. This happens a lot. It's not like rocket science. Most of you probably know this, but it happens even for me when I sit at a customer. Happens every now and then that I forget this, and then we spend like 5 minutes debugging this. So I decided to put this into the presentation because it annoys me. It's only the latest tag that will automatically have the API server put image pull policy always into your cluster. Right? If you call this dev, it sounds like it should do it too, but it doesn't. It's only latest. All the other ones are tags for Kubernetes. If you had latest at some point and you now just change the image tag to some version, this does not remove the image pull policy always, even though it has added it without you asking specifically for it, right? This is really annoying to forget. And then last but not least, if you do kubectl apply and your tag is latest, it does not trigger a rolling update, right? You need to manually kill your pods or change something else in the manifest every time to also trigger the rolling update. Customize has a few helpers for this. Well, you can use the config map generator, which will include some hash, and then something changes that actually forces the redeploy. There's ways how to deal with this. I think this is the most painful in CI/CD, right? When you want to automatically deploy your test environment, and what I would recommend doing there is to use something like manually overwriting actually not using latest, but using a specific tag that is from this CI/CD build. And there's different ways how you can get this into your manifest before you apply it to the cluster. One of them being customizes set image tag functionality, right? That I showed earlier, which again you can also run from the command line. You don't have to put it into the manifest manually first. Day four. So if you've done all the above stuff before, then I think you have got the basics of your application covered, and it's now about making your application resilient. And there's a bunch of features that I think everybody should be doing before they look into anything more advanced. First thing is don't run your clusters as root. This is possible now. It's not hard. Just do it at the security context thingy. Pick a user ID that's not used on the host, depending on what your host operating system is. 1,000 might not be a good idea, right? But if it's something like, I don't know, Container Linux, then there's probably no user, so you should be fine. CoreOS. We renamed the operating system at some point, and then everybody was indoctrinated to stop saying CoreOS when we meant the operating system. And then Red Hat bought the whole thing and was like, nah, we really don't like this name, Container Linux. Can we just call it CoreOS again? And now I have to go all the way back. It's really terrible. So when I say Container Linux, I mean it's still CoreOS or whatever. There's the user and copy with the --ch own. This helps in your Docker files when you want to run stuff as root, as non-root, to make sure that you can actually read those files you put in there and you copy from somewhere or from the internet and stuff like this. And then just use the high ports inside the containers and use a service to map from the low port to the high port, right? It's very easy. Next slide. Health Z, I guess. It's really difficult for a German to pronounce. We are the Germans for a reason, right? Two things, liveness probes and readiness probes. First, use specific endpoints, please, and optimally different ones for both of them that verify actually if the application is working. And then readiness probe and liveness probe have two similar but distinct purposes, I suppose. The readiness probe first basically controls if this pod is included in load balancing, if this pod is included in the list of endpoints of your service. It does this both when the thing comes up fresh, when the pod just came up fresh. It also does this if the readiness probe starts failing at some point during the lifetime of this pod. It will also get removed temporarily and added back in. So if you have like a dedicated endpoint for your readiness probe, what you can do is say, I'm currently not great. This application instance is currently not great, but I don't need it to be like restarted. Maybe it's good enough, it's just taken out of load balancing for a little while, and then it can move back in. Because moving stuff around in your cluster does actually, you know, affect other stuff. So avoiding having to do that is usually a good thing, even though Kubernetes gets really good at just handling it. And then the liveness probe, this is the one that when it fails, it will actually restart your pod. And so the idea, because the idea behind this is that if you have different endpoints, you can be like, if I can just temporarily not reach my database or something like this, or I have too many threads running right now that are waiting for some I/O or something, I take myself out of load balancing and, you know, calm down like a little bit. But if something is really badly broken, then maybe a restart might fix it. The Windows admins certainly know that it does, I guess. So you have health checks. Next step is adding resource limits and resource requests. I strongly suggest to do it in this order, because without the health checks, it's sometimes kind of hard to know why your application suddenly isn't working anymore after you've added the limit. So this is why this order, right? I would recommend to always set requests and limits. When I talk about the QoS classes in a bit, then this sounds like a stupid idea, but because there is a QoS class that's dedicated to not setting requests and limits. But I would still, should be the exceptions. If in doubt, set requests and limits. Okay, and then QoS classes, there's three that Kubernetes knows right now: guaranteed, burstable, and best effort. Guaranteed is when you set requests and limits to the exact same value. What happens is the request is used by the scheduler to find out what node is capable of running the workload that you're trying to schedule, right? And the scheduler will only look at the resources that are available on the node and what you requested. It will not look, and it will look at the sum of all the requested resources of all the pods on that node, which means it will not look at their actually memory usage, for example. It will just look at their requested memory usage. So when you set a request, then you are guaranteed to end up on a node that actually has this much memory free when you are put there. Okay? If you have the limit higher than your requests, it means you are in this burstable QoS class. And this means that your application can will end up on some node that has enough free memory as you requested, but you can burst out a little bit. But you run the risk that if you are above what you requested, that you might be evicted from the pod, from the node. Sorry, the pod might be evicted from the node. And if you go above your limit, you have a very high chance going to be OOM killed. Okay. And then best effort. Those can actually consume as much CPU and memory as they want because they don't have any limit, right? They also haven't requested anything, so the scheduler really has no idea where to put them, so it just will put them somewhere. But those are the very first to be evicted or killed if there's any resource shortage, right? Do yourself a favor. There's the resources, handling resource limits and requests. And there's the QoS classes documentation page. Go read those a couple of times. They're very useful in understanding why you are in a lot of pain sometimes when something isn't working, right? Those pages are your friends. Node pool and memory limit pitfalls, yeah. So the first one is I don't do a lot of Java, but I've recently spent quite a fair bit of time fixing this problem with a customer. I don't know, like maybe half a day, and it was really annoying. The problem was we did actually know that we didn't have Java 10, so we were supposed to use those two experimental Java VM options that basically read the C group memory limit and then apply Java memory limits accordingly automatically. Apparently Java 10 does this in itself, and so those options are already deprecated now. But what we basically did is because of the jar being referenced in the Docker file and those memory things we passed in as arguments in the Kubernetes deployment, they ended up being behind the dash jar command line parameter that we passed to Java. And so they are apparently ignored. The jar runs without those flags. You have to put them in front. So, you know, it might save you half a day or maybe not. If you don't do Java, you don't care, I guess. And the second thing is this applies to all languages. I've had this with Python, I've had this with Java. It's basically a lot of frameworks, especially when they are starting multiple processes or they're starting multiple threads. They oftentimes have like a default setting to be like, okay, start, I don't know, 20 threads per CPU core or start one process per CPU core or stuff like this, right? This is all nice, but the problem is if you set a limit for CPUs and you count, you take a look at the number of CPUs from inside the container, it's still all the CPU cores that the host system has, right? But you might have also limited memory. If the Java framework or Python framework would try to find out how much memory is available, it also sees the whole amount of memory that the host system has, not unless it looks specifically at the C group memory limit set. This is the only way how it can find out that it actually is limited to something less. And so what happens a lot is that people have those default settings, and then they have multiple node pools, for example, and some nodes have more CPUs than others, but you've set a memory limit. So when your pod gets scheduled on this other node, suddenly it starts more threads, doesn't fit into the memory limit anymore, and gets constantly OOM killed, and you're like, what the fuck is going on? This is especially terrible if you switch completely over from smaller nodes to new nodes, all of them roll over, and suddenly all your applications keep crash looping, and you have no idea why. And then oftentimes this is why. So my recommendation is, if you go containers, set those things specifically, set them to one CPU core, set them to like a reasonable memory limit, start threads that are reasonable for your memory limit, amount of threads that's reasonable, and then just use replicas if you want more CPU cores. Just scale out horizontally. It's the better approach anyway, right? Ah, amazing. How much time do I have left? 5 minutes. Wow, I have only like two more slides, so this is perfect. Day five is for the advanced topics, okay? So I think at this point, you've done this, you've covered all of those must-have basics, in my opinion. There's a lot of more stuff that you will have to learn, and a lot of you will probably also know much more than that already, but I think this is kind of like, I have to find some common ground, and I felt this is the, I feel comfortable, everybody needs to know stuff. Day 5 is when you can get fancy. So day 5 is after you've gotten the stability right and you have sustainability. So you can see what's going on. You kind of understand how your applications behave on the new cluster and what Kubernetes does to them under certain circumstances. So you don't sit there introducing, I don't know, horizontal pod autoscaling or horizontal node scaling, and suddenly everything starts breaking. You don't know why, and everything is moving, and it's very hard to figure out why it's breaking when the environment constantly is changing around you, right? So this is why get those two things first, know what you're doing, get the basics right, and then get fancy. And then you can go like pod security policies, network policies, you can add a service mesh, you can do mutual TLS, which is amazing, but also very, very painful to debug if it's not working. You can use advanced deployment strategies, you can do rate limiting and authentication of who's talking to your APIs. All these features are available, they're very useful, and some of those might be strict requirements before you can go into production. That doesn't, however, mean you have to do them at the very beginning. It just means you can't go into production on day 4. You have to wait until day 5, right? And I guess that's my presentation. I hope I did not offend anyone with the Helm stuff. I didn't mean to. Still, don't use it. Thank you for your attention. And if you have any questions, I'm available maybe now for a few minutes or also later in the backstage area.
Thank you very much, Philip.